Of the morning, I see some people are still returning to their internet hutches. All right, but just to keep things on schedule, our next talk is by Stefano Saramanelli from IPT, SACLE, The Threshold of Descending Algorithms and Inference Problems. So thank you very much, Stefano.
Thank you, Chris, and thank you to all the organizers for keeping up this nice event and for inviting me here. So I'm going to show some results that are coming from a collaboration with the people in the slide, Giulio Biroli, Chiara Camarota, Franz Zaccara, Pierfrancesco Urbani, and Lenka Zdeborova. The aim of this work is to understand the behavior of the descending algorithm in inference problems. By descending algorithms, I mean gradient-based algorithms that define a proper loss function or a Hamiltonian are just updating the parameters in order to go down in the gradient. So in this class of algorithm, we may have some noise term here. And in particular, when we have a thermal noise that is Gaussian and white, we talk about Langevin algorithms that are pretty much used in inference and signal processing as it allows you to sample the perceived probability. Otherwise, if the noise term is not present, we just have a gradient flow that is the continuous version of gradient descent. Nevertheless, we have also variations such as momentum, where we have inertial terms that you can add to this dynamical equation in order to speed up convergence. And in some cases, you can also define a stochastic gradient descent, which is, for instance, common when you have a training set, and instead of computing the gradient with respect to all the entries of the training set, you just take some batches. And you compute the gradient on those, which is computationally efficient and has some very nice properties that are well studied and not that well understood. In any case, during my presentation, I will just focus on the Langevin algorithm and the gradient flow algorithms. I will try to answer those questions, like what is the best, the performance of the algorithm? Can I find the best possible solution? So somehow I will have to clarify what is the meaning of performance in a particular, in a specific model. And then I would like to relate the behavior of those algorithms with some static landscape properties, such as what is the role of local minimum? Do they stop the dynamics if I have many spurious local minimum? So for instance, the usual narrative for a landscape looks like the one in the picture is that if I initialize my dynamics at random, my algorithm will probably end up in some local non-informative minimum and will follow one of those paths. So we'll probably not find a good solution. So according to this narrative, when my landscape becomes convex, as the one in the picture, then given some simple condition of the learning rate in my gradient descent, I will find a good solution. So this is the questions that I will answer during the presentation. What I will show you is that the trivialization of the landscape is actually not necessary to find the optimal solution. I will show you a specific model where this is not necessary. And I will show you that some particular local minima are extremely relevant to understanding the algorithmic performance, and I can characterize the algorithmic threshold studying those local minima. So basically, this is the plan for the presentation. But the first thing, of course, is how can I study, how can I characterize the dynamics? So in general, we don't know how to characterize the dynamics, but in particular cases, like in linear networks, where there is an explicit solution of the dynamical equations. Otherwise, I have to rely on particular cases or particular kind of algorithms. For instance, I can do progresses in the case of one-pass stochastic gradient descent. So one-pass stochastic gradient means that I have a data set and I observe a single data point at time, and I discard the data point forever. So this takes care of the correlation in the data set and will simplify the equations. And I can define in the large input dimension limit, I can define a set of ODEs that can integrate and characterize the dynamics. And all these regard some order parameters that I have to define. Otherwise, another approach is in the case of two-layer neural networks with the hidden layer that is diverging in dimension, I can map the dynamical equation of the individual neurons into the dynamical equation of the distribution of the weight in the neurons. In this case, I end up with a PDE that can possibly solve and characterize the dynamics as well. But the method that I want to study and then I will use in the rest of the presentation is the dynamical infield theory approach, which is something that is launched in the late 80s in the community of disordered systems. It has been applied already to recurrent neural networks and more recently in inference and optimization problems. More in general, you can apply this kind of approach whenever you can apply replica theory. And it's very nice in the sense that you can study gradient descent, stochastic gradient descent, of course, in a continuous formulation, and Langevin dynamics as well. And it consists of mapping the dynamical equations into an effective dynamical equation of a single neuron or particle that is affected by colored noise. The difficulty is that the stochastic process of the colored noise depends on the dynamics itself. So you have to evaluate the dynamics and the stochastic process, and you have to iterate those equations until convergence, which makes things a bit complicated, at least computationally. But nevertheless, this is doable. In particular, I will choose a specific model where the dynamical mean field theory DMFT equations are pretty simple, and that I can study in details also using other techniques. The model is the spike matrix tensor model that it was introduced just before under the name of the mixed p-spin model. This is the planted version of the mixed p-spin model. This is just the computer science jargon. The idea in this case is to try to find the low rank structure of a matrix and a tensor that you observe, and that they are given by this Y matrix and this T that is an order P tensor. So you create, you construct an estimator that is this X, and you try to minimize the distance between the matrix constructed by XX transpose and Y and the tensor constructed given X by the tensor observed. Now, the matrix and the tensor are constructed in such a way that they do have a low rank structure. So I generate a sample, a signal uniformly on the sphere that is this X star, and I can construct the matrix and the tensor in this way, but I have to add also some Gaussian noise. So I have this parameter that you can see here, delta 2 and delta P, that are basically the variance of my the noise in the tensor and the matrix, and basically they are the parameter that I will use to draw my phase diagram. And of course, the goal is to find X as close as possible as X star. the reason why we choose this model is that the dynamical infield theory equations are closed, and in the sense that the stochastic process is completely determined. So I don't have this iterative equation to solve. I just have some PDEs that may be complicated but doable. And also the model is complex enough that I have many computational phases for delta 2 and delta p that are of order 1. And finally, I can apply other techniques that I will use in order to understand other properties of the, of this problem. So this is the only technical slide about the MFT, just to tell you a bit more about the technique. In this case, I am considering the thermodynamic limit, so the input dimension of x is going to infinity, and I define some order parameters C, R, and M. Those order parameters obey a set of PDEs that are here at the bottom of the slide. I don't want you to read the PDEs. If you are familiar with the mixed p-spin or the p-spin model, you will recognize many of the terms that appear also in this kind of model. The only thing that we can that we should recognize is that those equations can be just studied using standard PDEs integration techniques, and those parameters will have all the information that I will need in my dynamics. In particular, I can compute the energy or loss in time. I can compute how much my estimator is close to the target signal, so x star, and so on. So far, I introduced the technique, I defined the model. Now we can start drawing some phase diagrams. And the first thing that I want to do is to draw some reference lines just to understand the region of the phase diagrams. So here I'm just considering AMP that has been introduced in the previous talk and also in the past days, which is just an algorithm in the family of the message passing and the leaf propagation algorithms. And this gives me the phase diagram that you can see on the left. On the horizontal axis, you have the variance of the noise, of the noise of the tensor. In this case, I'm considering an order 3 tensor, but I can do it for whatever kind of tensors. And on the vertical axis, I have a 1 over the variance of the matrix of my that I observe. So you can see that if the variance of the matrix is very simple, which basically is the same condition that we saw in the previous presentation, my data problem is easy, and approximate message passing can find the optimal solution. So in this case, if I can compute the optimal solution from other analysis, and I can see that AMP matches the solution when initialized from random configuration. If I reduce the signal to noise ratio, so I increase the variance of the matrix, I end up either in the hard phase where approximate message passing finds a solution that is no better than random guessing, and a optimal solution is available. So this is the hard phase. Otherwise, I can end up in the impossible phase where the problem is information theoretically impossible. So I cannot do anything at all. Now we can see what does the DMT tells us. So if I consider a Langevin algorithm and I evaluate numerically the DMT equation and I extrapolate the algorithmic threshold for Langevin, I will obtain this line here. I obtain this line here. So above this line, Langevin algorithm is finding the optimal solution. Below this line is not anymore. And in particular, between this line and the hard phase of AMP, I have an hard phase for Langevin as well. I'm considering Langevin algorithm with temperature 1 here, because in the long time limit, this will sample the posterior distribution. And therefore, this is the bias optimal thing to do. But of course, to sample correctly the posterior distribution, I should wait for a time that is long enough. And this may be exponential.
Stefano?
Yes?
So if we varied the temperature away from 1, would that curve only get worse? Or would it, in some cases, get better to the, it get closer to the horizontal threshold?
So it will get worse. You can do something that is a you can do some tricks to improve the performance. For instance, if you define different, you can define a mismatch model, which basically means that you have two different temperatures according to the different observation that you have, and you tune them carefully. In that case, you can improve and you can get as close as you can go get to the threshold of the AMP. But if you do just the simple thing, so you just use a temperature 1, you cannot do anything better than this, or with a fixed temperature, you cannot do anything better than this.
But so that's interesting, because these models with two different temperatures are presumably not Bayes optimal, right? So you're saying that they're better at finding that. That's curious. So this is a case where the algorithm to find the best algorithm of in this family to find something close to the planted assignment is not actually the Bayes optimal one.
Yes. So basically, what the idea in that case is that you have to, you can construct some annealing procedure where you reduce the temperature in order to get to the Bayes optimal temperature. But somehow this the path that you follow in temperature is avoiding the local minima. And this will simplify the landscape. But of course, if you wait long enough, this should get as close, this should get to the Bayes optimal threshold.
Right, so I guess I'm just wondering whether that means there's a region below that curve where finding something close to the planted assignment is easy, but the problem of sampling from the Gibbs distribution might be hard.
Yes, this is exactly what we find. This is exactly what I'm going to explain next. But in the case of grain descent, so in that case, I can just talk about minima and local minima, which is simpler to imagine. Okay, so the next line, of course, that I'm going to draw is the gradient descent line, which is obtained by setting the temperature zero in the gradient-based algorithm, and we can obtain as well using the DMFT equations, and this is not surprising, but this is worse than Langevin, as we are doing something that is not the Bayes optimal thing to do. And this is the algorithm threshold for grain descent. So now we have three algorithm thresholds, and we want to understand why do they differ, and what is blocking grain descent and Langevin dynamics from achieving the AMP performances. So let's focus on grain descent, where I can analyze the landscape properties of the problem, and I can try to study what is the distribution of minima. I can use the Katz-Rice formula to do that, and the result of this computation will give me the complexity. That is the annealed complexity that is defined as the logarithm or the average number of minima divided by n. I can be very specific for the minima that I'm counting. I can ask Katz-Rice to select only minima that are not informative, so local minima or non-or spurious minima, more in general. And a positive complexity means that I have an exponential number of spurious minima, while a negative complexity means that I have an exponential small number of spurious minima in probability. So the line at zero complexity is the trivialization line. And this is what you can see in the phase diagram here in purple. Above the purple line, the complexity is negative, so only the informative minima is minimum is there. Below this line, I have also an exponential number of spurious minima. But this plot is extremely interesting because if you compare the trivialization transition in purple with the gradient descent dotted line here, you can recognize that there is a region where gradient descent is working, but an exponential number of spurious minima is there. So this answers the first question. Trivialization of the landscape is a sufficient but not necessary condition for the convergence of gradient descent.
Stefano,
yes.
Like when you say you count the number of local minima, can you bound their energy as well? Like, can you say that there are, for example, very close to the ground energy, or or you know that they are like far, let's say, from there?
I can count. I can measure also the energy. In this region here, they are far from the ground state energy, and in fact the problem is information theoretically easy, so it's not impossible. You can distinguish between spurious minima and the ground state, and I can do that with cat's eyes.
I see. So the only reason I'm asking is because, you know, if you say gradient descent with random initialization works, could it be the case that just random initialization is good enough already as an energy, like to avoid this bad local minimum, or like energy-wise they are comparable, for example, with random initialization?
No, energy-wise they are not comparable. The energy is way below the random initialization.
So all the way up to the axis that you have delta 3, I see. Okay, thank you very much.
Yes. Thank you. Okay, so now
can you remind us what works mean here? So do you recover in the Bayes optimal way, or what does work mean?
Yeah, it means that you recover in the Bayes optimal way. So you find it means that so if you look at the landscape and you look at the ground state, this corresponds to an estimator, and you find exactly the ground state.
I see. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so now to understand what is going on in this phase diagram, let me take a cut in the phase diagram. Now I'm just fixing delta 3 to a value, and I'm try to see what happened in this region. And the cut is giving me something like this. So on the vertical axis now I have the value of the loss, and I can see that the ground state is the blue minimum. The optimal solution is the blue minimum that is here. And in the easy region, I don't have a spurious minimal anymore, so I can easily understand why gradient the flow is working. But now, in this region where there are spurious minima and ground state is detached from them, what is the difference? I cannot tell anything at all at the moment. And there is something that we're missing, and the ingredients are the threshold states that have been studied in the early 90s in the disordered systems community. That basically means that when I start my algorithm at random, the threshold states are the states where I end up first. And they are defined in the random setting, so no planting, no signal there. And basically they correspond to those minima that are up here in my cartoon. If I draw the evolution of the loss in time for a different value of delta 2, you can see that those lines are approaching first and eventually they depart from these dotted lines. Those dotted lines are the threshold states energy. So I can characterize the threshold states. I know what do they mean. I can compute the distribution. I know lots of things about them. So let's try to introduce the threshold states into the picture, and let's see what happens. So I introduce the threshold states, and I can see that exactly the transition that the algorithm transition gain descent, the threshold states become saddles. So the picture that you should have in mind is that your dynamics will start randomly, will first fly to the threshold states, and then will eventually realize that they are saddles and will follow the negative direction. And you can compute the negative direction and this points toward the signal. So in this region where the algorithm is working, basically you bypass the spurious minima because you end up to some minima that they became stable and they are pointing toward the good direction. So I can use the information that I know about the threshold states to obtain those two equations. The first one is just telling me I am at the threshold state. And the second one is just telling whether the threshold states are stable or not stable. And as you can see, this is, can be done for arbitrary t, so this doesn't apply to grain descent only, but to whatever kind of Langevin algorithm you can think of. And you obtain this equation that if you put into the phase diagram, you obtain the solid gray line that nicely agrees with the numerical extrapolation that I've done before. So we have a theory that works pretty well in the mixed PSPN model. And now I can jump to the conclusion. What I wanted to say in this presentation is that the gain descent works can work even in a positive complexity region by escaping the spurious minima without having some any trick to do that. It's just the descent that leads to the good minima. And there are some local minima that are more important than the others, that are the threshold states. And in this particular model, I show that the threshold states really give the algorithm threshold gain descent. Now, I have new results that I don't have time to show in the presentation, where we apply the same techniques to simple neural networks, in particular the phase retrieval program that has been discussed already yesterday. And in that case, you have the trivialization of the landscape that occurs for a signal-to-noise ratio that is of order logarithm or the input dimension. And you can show that instead, gain descent is working at a signal-to-noise ratio of order one that is way closer to the algorithmic performance that you do in a particular simulation. And okay, that's all. Thank you. Those are the references for the talk.
Hi, so there are a couple of questions in the Q&A. Akash, can you go live or shall I read your question? I guess I'll read the question.
You have to read the question.
Okay. In setting up your equations, do you use random starts or do you take M of zero to be positive and then send M of zero to zero after N as a function of N?
What is Ln? Yes, I consider a small but not infinitesimal initialization. So this is not exactly a random initialization, but it is close to the simulation. If you run simulation, you will find the performance as the one that I show you in the plots. So this is not really a random initialization. It's close to random, but not exactly random.
Okay, and another question from Andres Corrada. Have you considered turning this into an optimization problem for recovering the planted ground truth? If you consider ensembles of noisy teachers, some of the parameter space you characterize as hard becomes solvable with an L1 minimization algorithm a la compressed sensing. In the dimension of the number of members of the ensemble, there are also phase transitions of solvability.
Yeah, so the point of this work is actually not really to find the best optimal algorithm. In the end, what we are doing is not at all the best thing to do. And as you can see from the performance of AMP that I drew at the very beginning, So it's more to understand what is the behavior of a gaming center in a simple setting that I can study in close detail.
Okay, so sorry, I'm a little slow here. Akash, you have a follow-up question, and I'm trying to find you in the participant list to unmute you. If you do the raise hand option, that will move you to the top of the participant list so that I don't have to page up and down. There you are. And okay, you are now unmuted, I believe. Or not?
Hello?
Yes, hi.
Hi.
Yeah, Stefano, I'm asking because, so in our paper with Gerard and Reza from earlier this year, we showed that for these mixed tensor matrix models and phase retrieval that STD, at least online SGD, cannot recover the signal in order n log n time, started from a uniform at random start. But if you give a little bit of a warm start, then you can actually recover quickly. So I guess my question is this Kugliano-Kurshan approach somehow going to be different between GD and SGD? Because I would imagine SGD versus GD is like n log n time for SGD.
Yeah, for sure, the two approaches are way different because in here you are taking care of all the correlation in the data set. In your case, do you do one pass SGD or you are doing the mini batch SGD?
One pass SGD.
Yeah, okay. So I think the problems are a bit different in this case.
I mean, because I would think that, you know, usually like, I mean, take even the case of PCA, n log n time for S, you know, online is, in a sense, log n time for gradient descent. And I mean, even just computing the top eigenvalue, if you use gradient descent for PCA, you'll need log n time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you have a log n time actually appears, but this is in the time. Yeah, okay, I'm not considering the log n in the time. I'm just considering the log, just considering the signal to noise ratio in this case.
Okay, I see there's a kind of existential question from Andres Corrada. I'm going to unmute you. Andres, do you want to ask your question?
Sure. I'm kind of at a loss to understand. You're trying to understand how machine learning algorithms can perform well in the real world. But you set up a sort of learning problem that's very far from what actually happens in the real world, where noise is not so highly correlated. I mean, homogeneously correlated features is terrible, right? I mean, between a learner. I mean, if I had a teacher that was, you know, like that, I would quit that school, right? I mean, you want people who are very independent in their noise along different dimensions. So,
yeah.
So the spin model, in fact, is you know, what you really want to learn in the world, or what learners are trying to learn is a landscape that's much more spiked than what you're showing. That's basically my argument, and I can be offline.
Yeah, sure. I agree with what you're saying, and I think we are very far from a real setting. This is just a step forward to understand why we have some negative results that appear in the literature, but they are somehow defeated by just practically running the algorithms in real settings. So we know that in many situations, we should have an exponential number of spurious minima in a learning with neural networks, but in practice, they just work. And one of the reasons that we are just saying that gradient descent can escape the spurious minima.
But my argument is that part of the explanation that they work is because noise in the real world is sparsely correlated.
Yeah, I agree. That is an explanation as well.
Okay. Then we agree.
So we're going to take a 5-minute break. Refreshments are available in your kitchen, and we'll be back at 10:20 for Pravesh's talk. So thank you very much, Stefano.